is that there are safer ways to test yourself. Like you're saying, there's CrossFit, there's martial arts. There's so many different ways you can put yourself and do fire testing. I call it fire testing, where you can actually purposely put yourself in a safer, more controlled environment where you're putting your body through stress and you're putting your mind through stress. And the question is, can you survive that? Can you overcome that? Because today it seems like it doesn't take very much for people to give up. I see it all the time. They give up. They're like, oh, a little bit of an obstacle. I'm checking out of here. You know what I mean? And it's kind of like, well, hold on a minute. You have these big dreams and these big goals, and you're alive for a reason. You're here for a reason. You've got some kind of potential to actualize into the world, and you're just going to fold at the first little obstacle. Where did that come from? It's like our culture has gone in the opposite direction. And that's why I feel there's so much value going back to the ancient past from these warrior traditions and bringing out the best parts of them just so that we can maybe change that and people can actually fulfill their own lives.
Yep. And part of the ancient one I would talk about is, or I would acknowledge, at least in my readings, is that a lot of it wasn't egoically driven, right? The ancient warrior ways. There was community that was important. There were other things. And you talk about the fire. So I'm also a firewalk facilitator. So Tony Robbins, you know, the firewalking. So the thing is with this now, it's become, I'm not going to say so popular that people have walked on fire. You can't probably talk to 10 people without one of them walking on it. But the challenge is, did they walk on it from ego or did they walk on it from their soul? Most people walk through the fire from ego. And so they don't have that life-changing events like, see, I did it. I didn't get burned. Oh, I'm cool. Right? As opposed to walking through it with their soul. What is their soul trying to tell them? And I think that's where the ancient wisdom came in. It was all, most of it was soul-driven. And taking apart the battles, which probably everybody is, you know, not everybody, but a lot of people, well, what about all the battles and cutting off the heads and doing all that? That was for community. That was for to survive, if you will. But you go look into the training, at least from what my interpretations are, a lot of it was soul driven and meaningful as opposed to egoic driven.
Yeah, it's a good point. And I mean, when I look at the literature, because I've spent my life now, and I was very inspired to do this, of looking back at these ancient cultures in the past and saying, okay, well, we've got every civilization and every community and every tribe has a warrior class. It's almost like that's the immune system of the tribe. That's what fights off the pathogens, right? And of course, because we're human and because there's the other side of the component of human psychology and everything else, you will see people that abuse those skills. You will see people that, you know, maybe call themselves a warrior class or put on the uniform and wear the whole thing, but they don't subscribe to the philosophy. They're just there for their own
mercenaries.
Exactly. They're mercenaries for hire, or they're fighting for some emperor that has, you know, malintent or you know, whatever. There's always that. So I think people mix up examples in history of where there's been corruption in that, in the warrior classes or in various movements of civilizations or whatever. And they kind of equate that with, oh, well, the warrior thing is something we need to get rid of in people today because we need a passive sort of dumbed down population so that we're not smart enough or passionately driven enough to commit acts of violence. And it seems like there's a lot of pressure to really dull the senses with people and really just bring them outside of that. Whereas in the warrior culture, it was about enriching that, not for the purpose of just going around and conquering and pillaging and raping, but for the purpose of defending and realizing that not all groups of people and human beings are going to get along, and there needs to be a function of self-defense. But then again, there was that level where it was more than even that. It was an individual process. It was like what Bruce Lee said, all knowledge is ultimately self-knowledge. And that was something that rang so true for me when I was coming up with this stuff.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And then you can look at it from an archetypal perspective, right? The warrior is the one that takes action. And when you look at it, that's really what – if we look at it from a Carl Jung, although Carl Jung wasn't around during the samurais, but they were manifesting that warrior energy. So, right, an archetype is an energetic pattern within us. And the four big ones, right, is the warrior, the magician – the lover and the king or the royal. And when we can and so back then they were manifesting those archetypes, meaning take action, get things done. And if we don't have that warrior type, it's we sit on a couch all day and don't do anything. So even just from an archetypal perspective, the warrior has to be embraced if we want to get anything done.
Awesome, man. Dude, we got to have you back more. I love this. This is great. I'm so glad you're talking about this, because sometimes when you're doing this, I don't know how you feel, Greg, I feel like sometimes I'm alone talking about this stuff.
Yeah,
and it's hard to communicate this. And I've done my best. I've done presentations, I've done shows, and I've had people on. But to communicate the depth of this, this is what I was interested in, man. When I first started looking into martial arts, it was the esoteric side of it.
Yes.
It was the spiritual component. It was like, well, okay, there's warriors and they're pretty badass. They know how to do all these different things but what's behind that? What's behind that confidence? And then I met I was at a conference once. I think I was probably about 18. I was at a martial art event, and they had, what you did was every 45 minutes you would change mats and you would train with a different master of a different martial art. So it was one of those. Wow. I love those events. And one of the event, the only master on the entire mat, there must have been 40 different instructors there, that was talking about the philosophy of it, was this Aikido master. And usually Aikido, typically they bring that out because Ueshiba was really into that stuff, right? So a lot of Aikido guys will talk about it. But this guy was unique. He just had a really good way of speaking about the philosophy. And I went over after, and I was young, and I was trying to wrestle with this whole thing about, well, I don't want to be a violent person because I'm practicing knife fighting over there and how to carve someone up like a Christmas turkey. And
right.
I love it. I want to train it. It's so cool. But I feel weird about the violence. And then I don't know where my direction is. And so I went up and I was like, Sensei, can I just ask a couple of questions? He's like, sure. I'm like, well, what are we really doing this for? Like, why are we doing this? Because I love it, but I want to know, like, I want to feel good about myself. I want to feel like I'm doing something that's right and moral. And he said to me, he goes, what you're really learning is you're learning about how to discover the truth. And you're learning about how to become a warrior. And he goes, what does that mean? He goes, in life, you're going to face challenges, internal and external. And you're going to need the spine of a warrior in order to face the truth about yourself and about the world.
Mm.
And I went there and I was like, can we talk more, man? This is what I want to know. And as a young person that was missing some of those things, and I know many young people maybe watching this maybe weren't taught these things.
Yep.
These are the cornerstones of what creates a healthy individual and will put you on the right path and will empower you and will give you the tools to go out and be successful. Could you comment a bit on that, Greg?
Yeah. I mean, you know, what came to mind is when you said that is also, it equates to what I've been doing some research on this for several years, is a rite of passage, right? So to become, you know, that warrior, there has to be that rite of passage, and you have to develop that spine to go through it. You have to develop all those other parts of it. But what I love about the physical, right, whether it's martial arts, CrossFit, or anything, the physical is a doorway into the invisible, right? But it's the invisible, our thoughts and our feelings and our emotions, right? All those are invisible, but it's the physical that gives us access to that. And when we have access to it through the physical, then we're able to inquire, why did I feel this way? Why did I get upset when I was taken to the mat? Where's this anger coming from? Right. But if we don't do anything, we're not going to, I mean, you could sit at home and maybe get mad because your cable went out, but that's not going to do anything. But I think that, you know, that the physical part, and this is why I love martial arts and CrossFit, is that it forces you to go inside. And many people don't want to. Many people, they'll stay busy. They quote, stay busy. But what they're really doing is avoiding their inner voice. And the warrior has become, at least my belief, has become comfortable with their inner voice. They have tamed it. They have trained it. They know how to sit in silence because they've gone through all the physical part of it.
Oh, so important. We tend to, without this kind of experience, without this kind of training, people tend to avoid pain. And all kinds of pain and discomfort. It's as if they want it to be just easy and have everything brought to them. And our society gives a lot of handrails for that, right? Like with all the apps and all the fast food and all the quick downloads and easy access.
Yep.
There are positive aspects to that. But one of the negative things is it's kind of weakening people because it's forcing them, and our psychology is driven like this, to avoid pain. And in one sense, in a survival sense, the brain is wired and the body's wired to avoid pain for survival. But that can become pathological. That can become like, I'm going to avoid what's actually the pain that's good for me. Legitimate suffering is what you could call it. Is that as it's, this is what a lot of psychologists have framed it, that if you avoid the legitimate suffering in your life, you're creating all kinds of other structures of suffering that are going to come back to you as well. And so instead of avoiding all of these things, the warrior seeks it. It goes straight in and goes, I will face it. I am the storm. I am, yeah. and I want that. And I know that the more adversity that I can face and come out on top, I am sharpening my sword. I am strengthening my body. Yep. I'm strengthening my mind. And now I'm going to be more effective at what I'm doing. And I feel like this is such a huge component for people to really fully grasp.
Oh, absolutely. And I think the biggest battle is their shadow side, right? So getting back to archetypes, the shadow side. And again, I was just reading some things on Dark Night of the Soul, where we come to a point in our life where we feel that nothing matters. Like, I've been a phony my whole life. And this Dark Night of the Soul is where we come face to face with all our hidden parts of ourselves. But the warrior would go into that. The warrior would go, ooh, something's coming up for me. Let me go into it. What is this? What is this? As opposed to running away from it and trying to hide through it through gambling or, you know, whatever distraction was available then, they would go into it. And so, you know, this Dark Night of the Soul process really didn't start happening until more of a modern era, when we had distractions that prevented us from investigating these feelings, going deep into them, resolving them. It could even be something as simple as, you know, a fight with your mom when you were younger, but you covered it up and now it's manifesting someplace else. But the warrior, whatever that discomfort was, the warrior said, I need to pay attention to it. I need to go into it, as opposed to a lot of people go, they get discomfort and going, I need to run away from it.
Yes, exactly. And if you look at it in just first a practical sense for the warrior class, those individuals were the ones that were raising their shields to defend against, you know, attacking forces, right? Yep. So they were facing death in the real world every single day. In fact, the samurai tradition, they would actually call it the way of death. And people are like, well, that's kind of dark and scary. And it's like, well, no, what they're actually using that as an opposite side of the view to say, well, it's actually the way of life. But by saying it's the way of death, what we're saying is that we're acting, even though we're afraid of death and death might be the biggest fear, we're acting in spite of that, because that's how you act for life. Our life is finite. It could be over at any moment. But you're going through a process of facing your fear. And many scholars on warriorship have said that warriorship in history is really just a testament to human courage and how important courage and generating courage is. And I think a lot of people maybe think that courage is just, oh, I have no fear. I'm not afraid of anything. I believe personally that no, courage is when you are afraid, but you do shit anyways. You know what I mean?
Yep. And Carlos Castaneda talked about in his books that the warrior goes through life as if death is sitting on his shoulder. Right. All the time you go there, like you could, and then back to the samurais, right? Today's a good day to die. But when you take action as if it could be your last action, how courageous would you be? Right. If you knew nobody wants to just die on their couch watching whatever. Right. We want to get out there. We want to be living. We want to be experiencing things. So if we go through life as if, you know, death is on our shoulder or looking over our shoulder, how many more things are we going to take a chance at? How many more times are we going to take a chance, even for guys, asking that special girl out or asking for the raise or changing jobs or starting your business? Right. If you act as if, you know, we don't have all the time in the world, and the warrior class knew that, right? We don't have all the time in the world, so we have to make every day count.
Well, there was so good you say that. There was a scene in one of my favorite movies, The Last Samurai, where the Tom Cruise character, you know, he just got sort of taken by these samurai bandits, or he thought they were bandits, and he's like trying to understand what happened and what they want from him and all this kind of stuff. And the Katsumoto character, the samurai leader, he's telling him, listen, in spring, the snows will melt and the passes will open. Until that time, you are here. We are deep in the mountains and the winter is coming. You cannot escape. And I found meaning in that statement. And what that meant was, what are you going to do while you're here? And he was almost like, Katsumoto was challenging. He was like, you can't escape. You're a prisoner. What are you going to do about it? I want to test your mettle. And in life, sometimes people feel like that. They feel like they can't escape. And they want to find the perfect escape, and that's where the distractions come in, and that's where that pathological behavior can develop, and the challenges can get even worse. But when you just say, "All right, I'm here. I'm in this challenge right now. How am I going to deal with it?" Like, the circumstances are secondary. We can't just blame the circumstance. Go, it's that person, or it's that thing that happened to me when I was a kid, or it's that other group of people that are always oppressing me, or whatever. No. To be a warrior and to be successful, it's to say, yes, I'm here with all my challenges and all my flaws and all my this and all my weaknesses and all that, but I also have strength. And there's a way that I can cultivate that, and it's through the challenge that I cultivate that, not by avoiding it, you know.
And in that scene later on, right, then Tom Cruise distracts himself by getting drunk all the time, right? So here's what I'm going to do with my time. I'm going to get drunk and drunk and drunk. And then at one point, something shifted, right? Hey, I'm going to be what, you know, we don't know what that shift was really, what I found interesting in the movie, but there was a shift. And then he started to embrace, here I am. Hey, what can I learn? What can I do? And we need to do that in life. When we're in a painful situation, whether it's a relationship, whether it's work, if we distract ourselves by, you know, Facebook, drugs, anything, we're going to miss the chance to grow. But we can go, here I am. What can I learn from this? Like he did, then we can, that's the warrior, right? Is what can I learn from this? I'm in a situation. Yeah, it sucks, but what can I learn from it? How can I grow from it? And I think that's all part of the warrior mentality.
Have you ever heard of the work of Wilhelm Reich?
Yes.
So he developed the concept, for anybody that might not be familiar with this, he developed a concept called somatic intelligence. And he spoke about organ energy. And this was just his terminology for talking about something you brought up, Greg, which was that the body and the movement of the body and the functions of the body is the gateway to the spiritual or esoteric or subconscious layers of your being, right? So he was a psychotherapist, and he found a lot of success in his patients. Instead of treating them mentally and always looking at them as, you know, let's just go through the psychological processes, he started treating them through physical movements and exercises, and he actually developed a whole series of physical exercises, a lot of which resembled things like Tai Chi and just movements and stretching and breathing. And through that, he found that his patients were recovering a lot faster, and then he was able to penetrate a lot of the things on a psychological level. Did you have any?
I think that's similar to Feldenkrais also, right? Feldenkrais, a movement where you move very purposefully in that and pay attention to what the body is telling you. You know, and from his work, that's yoga, right? The essence of yoga as well. But yeah, that's what I love about the body. And when you think about it, you know, here it is, our body is this gateway to marvelous things of ourselves, our spiritual, our emotional. And how do we treat our body? I mean, it's, you know, my belief is our body is a reflection of what we think of ourselves.
Well said.
Right. So are we taking care of it? Are we out of shape? And this is where physical fitness is just not being a six pack ab. I mean, those things are nice, but it's more important to it. It's able to gain access to you know, thousands of processes of emotional and thinking. And I love that concept that you brought up, and I was familiar with his work, and it's just marvelous work.
Yeah, and it's needed again today. And I think even in schools, with the fact that children are just sitting behind these desks in many cases, although we're seeing a movement happening, which I'm really glad to see, of the change in that. But, you know, typically in the way that they teach children, you're sitting there, you're memorizing information. These kids are bored to tears. That's why they're all developing ADD and all these disorders, right? Quote unquote. And then the way to treat them is to just give them these drugs and then make them conform. And it's not building the potential. It's not the proper soil to build those crops, you know? I think that with what I like to do is when I go into a martial art, or sorry, if I go into a public school and I do, they have like coach days or parent teacher days or, sporting days, and you can bring in a local instructor from a different style of something. And I go in and I talk to these kids. Sometimes I go in and teach a workshop. It's just amazing to watch them at the beginning. They're kind of like, okay, what are we going to be doing with this guy? This is so boring right now. We're talking about philosophy. What is this? And then all of a sudden I get them up and we're doing jump kicks and pushing each other around and grabbing each other and wrestling around, and we're playing and we're rolling, and they're just, you just watch their eyes light up like, oh my God, this is so awesome. Why haven't I discovered this before?
Right.
And we're teaching them how to play. Like kids, you watch them. Even I've got two daughters. And they wrestle each other and attack each other all the time, and they're loving it, you know, until someone gets hurt. But the thing is what we're doing is we're teaching them something they already know innately. They know that they just need an outlet for this stuff, right?
Yes, yeah. And the school thing, you know, don't get me started on that, because all the school right now is just based still on industrial age. Everything's in a row, everything's in a line, and I mean that's a whole different subject. And so, you know, there's this concept of you know, do you work with the parents from a warrior's perspective so they will work with the kids, or do you bypass the parents and go directly to the kids? And, you know, there's two trains of thought on that. And I like the parents one, because if you can shift the parents, then they can affect others, where the kids may be up against some resistance from the parents. But either one is great.
Yeah, I guess it's case by case, you know, based on what the situation is. Unfortunately, we've got a lot of kids that don't have both parents in their life, or they don't, maybe they're adopted, or well, there's a lot of circumstances there. I mean, I run my own martial arts school, and I teach regularly, and I love teaching the younger ages, because they're so open to learning. I find it sad that a lot of martial artists that I've spoken to that I'll hire for workshops or talk to, they're just like, yeah, I never teach kids. I don't like teaching kids. And I'm like, what do you mean? Like, you have so much knowledge to give. Why would you skip the most important generation? I think the kids are what we need to really focus on. And yes, the adults as well. And I mean, we need everybody to be tuned into these kinds of principles, I think, to build a healthy society. But maybe I could ask you your opinion on the whole thing about dealing with criminality in our society. Because obviously the warrior class was developed to stop injustice, right? The principle of justice, if you look at all the codes of honor and chivalry and codes of the warrior, Bushido, justice is one of the big ones that jumps out. So this was the class that did that. How do you think that works with the warrior philosophy?
Well, that's a great question. That's a, you know, do you have another 5 hours worth of talk, right?
I'll have to do
more on this. So you hit something that's really important, which I think is at the underlying of society, and that is we in the Western society do not have a code of honor we live by. Right. We absolutely have abandoned it. We don't even know what a code of honor is. And you can look up, yeah, the military has codes of honor, but that's for their military. But men, women, us, we don't have codes of honor. So we will be susceptible to the winds of change. We'll be susceptible to anything to make decisions. Some of those decisions are bad, hence criminality. But then, you know, is selling a herbal plant really a criminal, you know,
just because
it's on the books this year, it wasn't on the books. It's like a speed limit, right? You know, last week it was 55 miles an hour or 60 miles an hour. And now it's 55. You just change a number. You drive the same. Are you really breaking the law? But that's, you know,
So if to clarify, then the justice principle is not just talking about how our legal system has become corrupted by bureaucratic, whatever, red tape for the purpose of benefiting small groups of people. That should be definitely highlighted. I think that what we need to return to, and maybe we can't just forcefully change the system right away, but if we can start with each individual to have them understand, okay, there is a natural law that exists in the universe, and it's the law of justice, meaning it's the balancing of the scales. And it's starting with your interactions. Like, I mean, if you look at, say, for example, this horrific atrocity that just took place in Las Vegas, or any of these horrible events that take place, you know, and these kinds of things happen around the world every day, where someone is breaching that sort of law of justice that exists between human beings, where they're going to take life, they're going to take property, they're going to take whatever. And I think even, the government is part criminal in that regard too, because, you know, we can get into all that at another time. But there are elements in our world and in our society that we're seeing that we could call injustice, because that's an element that is potentially there in all human beings, that we have that choice. It's like in Star Wars, what are you going to take? The light side or the dark side, the Jedi or the Sith, right? So like, if we look at justice as a sort of archetypal principle that applies to human behavior, it starts with you, and it has to do with not breaching the rights that we all know every human being has of another person, right?
Right. But and the challenge there, though, is what is the perception of the rights of another human being, right? This is where the social aspect comes in, and the geography of it. You know, what does somebody over in Pakistan believe versus Iran versus United States versus Canada? They all think they're right, and so we're all wrong. And so when you have justice, but this is where I think a code of honor for individuals, right? You know, as Gandhi says, be the change you want to see in the world. So it has to start with you, David. It has to start with me. We have to develop this code of honor, live by it. Just strictly, this is the way we live, and it may be a strict life, quote unquote, but it's a life where we know what we're doing is quote correct in our own environment. And then people will see that, right? Because here's the thing is we are, so a long time ago, a teacher told me we teach our kids whether we teach them or not. Mm. Well, we also teach our community whether we teach them or not. We're not underneath a microscope that we're so important that everybody's watching us. But when people watch us, we're demonstrating our ethics. We're demonstrating our code of honor. We're demonstrating that. And when we continue to walk that, as the Native Americans say, that good red road, then we're going to be able to be, we'll be noticed, and others are going to go, and, hey, I see you don't get upset. I see you're under control. I see this. What are you doing? Well, here's my code of honor. And then we can start to spread that. And I think then, you know, it's this groundswell movement that will come up to justice and will help with all of that. The challenge is people feel that they don't have any power. Right. They feel powerless into affecting a larger scale when in reality they have all the power in the world to affect their own scale.
Yeah, that's a great place to go with that, because your work, your coaching work, your website, the videos you do, the shows you do are about giving people the fundamental principles to developing the body and the mind and all the apparatus and everything so that you can realize that power. Mm-hmm. And I think that the question of self-esteem comes in huge here. Mm-hmm. And I think that topic of self-esteem has become very superficial in our modern day. But the real guys that wrote about self-esteem and going back to this warrior ethos, we're talking about just having that overall sense of knowing who you are. If you know who you are and you're connected to the authentic you at the core of your being, as opposed to that superficial construct that you create to interface with the world. Not to say that that's bad and we should get rid of it, but it needs to be the servant, not the master.
Correct. And
so what we need to do is really help people understand their potential. And that doesn't mean you're just, you're born, you're now amazing. Like, you have to actualize that potential. You have to do something with it, right?
Right. And this is where I think that a lot of people, one, are afraid of that. They don't know what that looks like. Right. And so they'll get involved with these topics of just political. We'll just call it political or economic topics, where it doesn't really affect them at that individual level. What happens in, you know, as far as trade agreements are concerned, how does it really affect? I'm not saying be ignorant to it, but really, if we're going to spend so much time,
if we're going to spend
so much time talking about it when it really doesn't affect our personal life, we're then shunning our personal life. We need to take responsibility for our personal life, not so much talking about, hey, when we go to the polls, we can vote. That's where we express it. You want to express it, you write to your congressman. You can do those things, but then to carry on 10, 15, 20, 50 hours of conversation where nothing gets resolved, but what happens is we ignore our life, then that's not a good thing.
Yeah, that's a crucial point, because what you're bringing up there is key, because it's easy to focus on problems that you know you don't have any control over. Like deep down, you know you can't, even if it's a corrupt thing, you can't control that, you can't change that. So it's easy to go out on the street and start making signs and protesting everything and going on and screaming at everybody, you need to wake up to this problem.
Right.
But what ends up happening is typically that's run by a lot of people that are doing what you're saying. They're ignoring their own personal development aspects first, because we can blame everything on society, but society's made up of us. It's made up of people.
Right.
Okay. And we need to find a place to start that's realistic. And this, and like, what did Carl Jung say? People will do anything, no matter how absurd, to avoid facing their own soul. I think that's one of the most powerful statements of our time to think about and go, that's kind of frightening, actually, that it's scary to look at both the good and the bad of you and the weaknesses and the strengths of you equally, not to because we tend to edit out the things we don't like about ourselves. You know?
Oh, yeah. And that, well, that, not just edit, we repress them. Right. And that's that shadow side that comes out in society. So, you know, I agree with you on that. And, you know, let's say we want to demonstrate. Great. You go out, you do it once, you're done, you move on. Right. So the key there, I think, is how much are you putting your effort into changing the world when you're not even changing your life? When if you change your life, you'll definitely change the world.
Yeah, well said. I mean, that's it in a nutshell. Well, let's move here. Let's go here, Greg. I was watching a video this morning where you were talking about success, okay? And I would love to hear your definition of success, because I can tell you you're a very holistic person in the way you approach this. Some people might determine success by, hey, I got a lot of money in the bank. I got a Ferrari in my driveway. I got the hot wife and I got the whole thing. And that might be success for people. I personally like the sort of Emerson way of looking at success, where it's like, you know, you get respect from respectable people. You're respected in the eyes of children, meaning that you are a good role model to others. You've actualized your potential. You've made this world just a little bit better than when you entered it. You've achieved success on all levels of being, the mental, mm-hmm. spiritual, physical, emotional. Could you talk about that?
Yeah, I think success for me is the progression towards a worthwhile goal. Right. So how do you define a worthwhile goal? Because my challenge with putting success and being respected by somebody, that's all external. Mm. What if that never happened, but you had a great life anyway? You did all the great things. So I think success is more intrinsic than extrinsic. And if we can get away from most people want to have success as extrinsic, like you said, the cars, the respect. I mean, we all want that. Even Tony Robbins talks about the six needs that we need. One is significance. We need to feel significant at some level. And I think that's important. And that's just on a side note, feeling significant can be shadow and light, right? You can feel significant by being a criminal. You're getting attention. You're in trial. People are watching you. And you can be significant by doing things good. So how do we match, or how do we fill that need? But I think success, I think if we can start to think of it more intrinsically, that what, you know, do you feel good about what you're doing? Do you feel good about the progression that you're making? And also, like you said, are you leaving your campsite better than you found it, right? That's the old thing, right? With camping, make sure your campsite is cleaner than you found it, right? I don't know if anybody knows that anymore, but that started way back in the national parks, right? And that's kind of like, you know, your life, leave your life better than you found it.
I love that, and I love camping. I live on the West Coast here in Canada, in British Columbia.
Okay.
And we just finished, my family and I went on a trek across all over the island, Vancouver Island. We were camping all over the place, and it's just beautiful. And what an amazing way to connect to nature. And then, yeah, like you said, you're going to clean up your campsite before you leave, because you're going to show respect to your environment,
right.
And then to the other people that are going to come in. And these are just, these sound like little trivial things to people, but they're very important, and there's bigger meaning, and they can impact your life on many levels.
Right.
And so
just to underscore that also, when I was doing some research on helping athletes out with their mental part, reading some books, and there's a couple of psychologists, and they all independently came up with this, what I'm about to say, is that how you do anything is a reflection of how you do everything.
And that is
that's huge.
Warrior principle, right? Like,
right.
That is totally like, right from how you serve tea to how you write calligraphy to how you,
to how you clean up your campsite,
build your website, all of that, the way that you approach everything is going to be how you approach anything. That is powerful. And I think that really gives people some perspective as to how to get out of whatever they're trying to get out of, you know, in their life.
Yep. And so, you know, your campsite thing is correct. So you spend the details of that respecting whoever's going to come in after you. And your life is like that. You do things maybe consciously or unconsciously that you're preparing for the next person to come in to help them with it. And I think, you know, you're living that lifestyle just from the discussions that we've had. And if people would really sit and contemplate that, you know, how we do anything is a reflection of how we do everything. That means what you do little, you're going to do big. And, you know, that little stuff is, like you said, pouring the tea, making sure things are correct, and all of that is so important. It gets organization in our life. It gets control of our life. We all think we're out of control, but all those little things add to the sense of control. And the warrior absolutely felt that they were in control of their life.
And that leads to productivity, right? Like, and one of the things that as human beings, we need to feel like we're actually being productive in life. I think it goes back to just that, if you think of it as basic survival, and then the fact that we now have this big consciousness that we can contemplate all these things on a deeper level. It started with just, I need to be productive so that I can provide food, shelter, protection for my family and my community. And then it grew into something even more metaphysical as time went on. And I think that's amazing. So if you're listening to this and some of this might be kind of over your head right now, just start with the practical things in your life, I would suggest. Right. And do you have any advice for people that they're trying, Greg? You talk to people all the time in your work. Right. They're trying to gain success in their relationships, in their businesses, in their jobs, you know, just practical everyday people. What would you say to them?
So one of the things is, you know, when I look at mental strength and the warrior mindset, there's four C's, right? There's control. Control is one of them. And I think that without getting into the other ones, but I think most of us feel that we're not in control of our life. So we can't be productive. We're at the mercy of somebody else out there. And one of the things that we can do is understand what we can control and start controlling it. It's like the serenity prayer, right? Right. But that's so powerful, is that when we know what we can control and then start to control it, we'll then feel like we do have control in our life, and then we'll set goals. And then we'll set goals and start to accomplish them. Then we'll feel better about ourselves, and we'll start to progress and move towards that. I will say one, I'm going to call it a mind hack, that I think is really fun, and probably nobody, I shouldn't say nobody, I don't know if anybody's heard of, but we all have self-talk, right? We all talk to ourselves all the time and go, man, why can't I get this done? Or how can I get this done? Or whatever it might be. If we're in a challenging situation, it's been proven that if we switch from first person, meaning I, to third person, meaning Greg, come on, Greg, get up, get this done. We will take action much more effectively and efficiently when we talk to ourselves in third person, because we disassociate ourselves from ourselves.
That's very interesting, eh?
Right. So if you're laying in bed, you want to get up, and you sit there and just go, come on, get up, get up, get up. And you'll fight with it. But if you go, David, come on, get up, boom. And I don't mean just the change in voice, but using your first name, you know, third person name, right, will help you get motivated and move. And so when we're trying to get things accomplished and we procrastinate and we do these things, man, I wish I could get this done. I wish I could just talk to yourself in third person and watch the shift happen.
That's really, really interesting, because it makes me think of all my coaches and senseis. I developed some pretty good self-discipline where I would go in and train and work on my own stuff, but I always train much harder.
Right.
When I've got my coach going, come on, David, get your ass moving.
Or
give me positive feedback, right? So you could become your own coach.
Well, that's it effectively also. And just, I see, you know, the pictures behind you with, so it's also been proven that if you put a picture up with eyes looking over your shoulder, you'll be more effective working, because it's just the sense of somebody's watching you. So it's that same philosophy, is when you talk to yourself and you want to get something done, talk to yourself in that third person. So you are your own coach.
And then it is helpful to have coaches like yourself, or, you know, I work in teaching in my own right, and there are many great teachers out there. It is helpful for people, especially when you're really down and you're just learning this. It's helpful to have somebody that helped guide you in the beginning. But the goal is to eventually be able to be self-made. That's what it means to be self-made, to be able to go out and you've learned this from great teachers, but now you can bring it into your own and you can express it in your own way. I see that as that's the process of martial arts. You come in as a white belt or whatever, and you've got no training or experience. You're nervous. You're kind of bewildered. And then you're shown these little tiny baby steps to just get your confidence going, get you moving, understanding the basic things.
Yep.
You've got to have an ABC template that you need to follow. But eventually, when you reach a certain level, you should start now being able to express your own uniqueness within that style or that discipline, right?
Right. That's the saying, right? A good leader produces other leaders, right? And so a good coach, a good teacher produces other, you know, the student is now the master, all of those things. And it is vital. And that's part of the warrior tradition, though, is the warrior tradition never said, don't take over. You know, you always have to stay below me as far as ranks and stuff. The warrior tradition always encouraged people to go further than they thought possible.
Well, that ensures the survival of the race. If you have the young generation, eventually being able to be even more efficient than you, you've done your job. But if you let the ego get in the way and you're like, well, no, I must always stay on top and that guy can never kick my ass in a sparring match and that kid can never, like, if you do that, you're holding people back from actually continuing this great thing. I mean, something like martial arts has been around for thousands of years and has evolved tremendously to what it is today because there were great teachers that built other great teachers.
Yep, exactly. And that's kind of what you and I are doing, is maybe not from a physical perspective. Well, you from a physical perspective for sure, but both of us from a mental perspective, is teaching people to go beyond us, go beyond our thinking, go beyond our limiting beliefs and see what they really can become.
Absolutely. And it's an honor to do it. Well, Greg, let's finish off. I want to give you an opportunity to maybe fill in any blanks on your work or tell people about where they can find you, what kind of courses you offer, any other little points that you think would be relevant for the listeners today.
Wow, David, thank you so much for that opportunity. Again, just enjoyed this conversation immensely. You're doing great work through your podcast and through your real life, and really respect you a lot for doing that. Again, my site is warriormindcoach.com. I'm more active on my blog, so warriormindcoach.com/blog. I do have a weekly podcast as well. My biggest, what I'm really proud of, is I have a couple of courses on Udemy. One is Develop the Mental Strength of a Warrior, and just go to Udemy and you'll find it. But the next course I just put up is called An Examined Life. And not to get too much into it, but, you know, Socrates said an unexamined life isn't worth living. And so in this program, I take people through the seven layers of an examined life. That's your vision, your mission, your values, your belief, your capabilities, your behavior, and your environment, and take them through all of that so they can really examine their life and come into integrity with themselves. So that's a course that could either take you 1 day or 1 year, but once you join, you have unlimited access to it. So I appreciate you letting me put that out there.
Oh, and please, I'm glad you did. And I'm going to come and check it out, man. I want to be a part of that. I think what you're doing is awesome. I'm glad I found you, Greg, and I'd like to keep this connection with you. And for the listeners, go and check out Greg's work, check out his website, follow his blog. My website is currently under construction, but it'll be up as well. I'll be offering more tools for you over at waythetruthwarrior.com. Thank you so much for supporting this show and tuning into this episode of Truth Warrior. We will catch you here again next week. And Greg, thanks again, my friend. It was a pleasure.
My pleasure. Thank you, David.
Awesome. All right, guys, that's a wrap. We're tuning out.